Welcome everyone to the video. Glad you're here. And in case anyone doesn't know, what we're trying to do is set a standard, an example of work ethic, because no one will succeed in realizing truth and non-dual abidance without tremendous work ethic. Just stick-to-itiveness every single day. Keep trying to do better, keep working at it. And we need role models for that in this world. It's so difficult because we look around, everybody's just goofing off, spiritually goofing off, lazy goofing off, not doing, and we think, wow, I don't want to stand out too much as working too hard. This all look like a weirdo or something. So it's brutally difficult. We don't have role models of those who really put in the effort. Let the world see it. So this is why I decided to do these videos. Share with the world the work ethic. This is what succeeds. Familiarity wins. Familiarity is what succeeds in terms of evaporating our continuity fear. Obviously, staying familiar with delusion doesn't help at all. We have to be familiar with truth. Getting familiar with truth, that's what wins. Now, I have a nice little antidote here to say in this regard. Someone, an acquaintance of mine, told me a little story today. It's a very interesting story. Make a long story short, he ended up in this gym late at night shooting baskets, and the only other person in this gym happened to be Kobe Bryant shooting baskets late into the night. This was just prior to the tomorrow's game for Kobe. And it happens to be a Kobe Bryant's retiring right now. And so there's a lot of people having opinions of him and saying, and what many say is that nobody worked harder than he did on his game. And this anecdote from my acquaintance, he says, you know what, I have personal experience of this. He also would start his workouts in the daytime, like about 4 in the morning. He'd go to the gym at 4 in the morning, lifting weights, shooting for hours, lifting weight, more weights. Nobody put more effort into the game, and he turned into one of the greatest players ever. Now, I don't particularly like him because he destroyed the Warriors, Golden State Warriors, for 20 years with mercy, no mercy. So if I was a Lakers fan, I might love Kobe Bryant. But he just absolutely dominated. But what I'm saying is he became so great at basketball because nobody worked harder than he did. And I would, this is probably a truth. So many say this, and my acquaintance verifying this says, hey, I literally experienced this. It's true. He would just take spots and shoot and shoot and shoot and shoot until it was just perfect, perfected, and go on the next spot and just go over and over and over. He never stopped giving everything he had to the game. So this is something that certainly most of us respect. This is how you get really good. It's the same thing with the spiritual path. Same thing. You have to want it to excel at it. You have to want to excel at it. And you have to give it everything you've got. And even though, and not let anybody even know what you're doing. Most of my life, nobody had the slightest clue of what I was doing, and still they don't. I don't tell, the only place I tell anyone is here on YouTube. I shared this, but other than that, I don't share it with anybody. Hardly anybody even knows I'm even taping, doing any taping at all, because I don't want to be singled out as different or strange, or why are you putting so much effort? You know, what are you doing? You should join the rest of us and stay, you know, lazy. This is the way it works. So I just keep it to myself and just keep working at it. This is, I feel, a very good example for others, because we're all in pretty much the same boat in this regard, is that when we really work at it, people are going to think we're kind of crazy. Say, why are you working so hard? Why don't you just go to church? Now, I was sitting in Catholic church last Sunday, and I had this amazing epiphany, this wow that just rocked me so strongly. And what happened was, I saw through organized religion, I saw what it's all about. Just like that. Now, I'm in the middle of the mass, so I can't get up and say, wow, everybody, listen to me. I was just like, I just got to get out of here alive. You know, I can't. Hopefully nobody knows what I just saw, because I said, oh my gosh, I understand what it's all about. And what it really is about is it's a way to divert ourselves away from what we really need to do, which is practice non-dual abidance, which is practice evaporating the continuity fear. And how it does this, it's very clever. What it does is it cultivates false spiritual sophistication. The rituals, you know, the wordings, the pomp, the music, the setting, everything. You feel like, hey, I'm spiritually sophisticated. I'm getting this experience at this church. I'm spiritually sophisticated. And then when we feel this nagging feeling like something isn't right because we're ignoring what we really need to do. We're ignoring what the one thing we need to do is practice non-dual abidance. We say, oh, you know, well, I don't really need to do that. I'm sophisticated enough. I mean, that can't be that important to me. It can't be that important because I'm really spiritually sophisticated. I go to church, and so this must be just a little problem that's really not that important to look at. It's a way of trying to avoid. It's an avoidance mechanism we've been using. Organized religion, for the most part, is an avoidance mechanism, actually. Plain and simple. So we try to build up this false spiritual sophistication so we can then say, well, you know, I've pretty much done what I need to do, so there can't be anything that important left for me to do. So this continuity issue over here, that can't be that important. So I'm not going to worry about it. And yet there's still this feeling that I don't feel right. So what they do then, the organized religion says, well, you sinned against God. You know, you have this guilt because God's angry at you. And you say, oh, okay, that's why I feel uneasy. So give this excuse. This is why I feel uneasy. No, we feel uneasy because we're avoiding what we're supposed to be doing, which is practicing non-dual abidance, practicing evaporating our continuity fear by full stop on the wow. This is the only way that works. So only non-dual abidance, practicing non-dual abidance, only that works. So only that has value. Nothing else has value at all. Nothing else here has value, actually. Only this practicing has value. And almost everyone here avoids doing it. Now, if I were to give a report to Jesus, for instance, of this world, or to anyone else, I would say, Jesus, that my report is that basically everyone here simply avoids doing what they have to do. They simply avoid it. And they have all these avoidance mechanisms. Many, not just organized religion. Education is an avoidance mechanism that we have here. Virtual entertainment, learning, just about everything here. This whole world is just one massive avoidance mechanism. And I say everybody just remains lazy and doesn't do what they need to do. This is just a fact. This is how it is here. They're not getting the job done at all. They're just priding themselves on how clever their avoidance mechanisms are. And thinking that, well, I'm so sophisticated, there can't be anything that important for me to look at, really. You know, so hopefully I just die and get to go to heaven and it's all good. And this is it. Nobody in the Catholic Church is, let me not be too much of a blanket statement, because historically, the Catholic Church has done a lot of good, but it's more recently it's gotten watered down very badly. So it's historically a mixed bag. I don't want any Catholics to feel offended at anything I'm saying, because I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's been a lot of helpfulness, and yet what has happened is it's run out of steam. It's stalled out very, very badly, which is what you would expect if you were just using it as an avoidance mechanism. I mean, you get what you get out of it, what you put into it. So there are some who have put into it what was needed to get out of it what was needed. There have been those. But for the most part, the masses right now, going to mass, they're not putting enough into it. They're just using it as a nice excuse to remain spiritually lazy for their whole lives. This is what is very, very apparent. Working on the continuity fears can be quite challenging. Very interesting, though. I can't imagine my life without it. It would be so boring, ridiculously boring. People live such unbelievably boring lives, in my opinion. All the celebrities, the big shots, everybody, such boring lives, such useless, utterly boring lives. Whereas my life, on the surface, it seems boring, but actually, It's been unbelievably rich and intense. Working on this continuity, if you're working to see what is the problem here? I mean, what's going on here? What is the problem? And what's the remedy? You see the problem, then you can focus on the remedy. So it you don't have, no one has to be a superstar to work hard on this, to work diligently, to do the tough work. You just, you know, be blue collar about it and just do it. That's all, just do it. And just looking in hindsight is just, it's an amazing path. It's like that tram ride video. You're going up the steep, and you're just like, wow, this is just amazing. You know, the steep path, but I am getting to the top here by using the tram. It's a lot easier than trying to climb up the mountain. So right spiritual practice takes us quite rapidly to liberation from delusion, the delusion of crystallization, compoundment, the idea that the delusion that pure spaciousness can be compounded, that is the fundamental delusion that we're suffering from. There is no compoundment of spaciousness whatsoever. None. Zero. Zero, 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 zero. And looking at all these zeros, these forms of zeros that we believe, and trying to draw meaningful distinctions among them is the activity of deluded mind. And we can set that entire activity down all at once, instead of trying to do it piecemeal, which would seem to stretch out forever. We can set it all down at once, but we don't need that evaluating. Jesus calls it thinking. I use the term evaluating. We're trying to evaluate in our mind. We're in this process of evaluation, trying to figure out, well, which of these illusory compoundments of pure spaciousness, which of those has more meaning than the others, and which has less, and how much meaning does each one have? And so we're in this process of evaluation. What we're really evaluating is nothing. There is zero compoundment of pure spaciousness. Zero. Nothing. Never taken place. Never will. So what exactly are we evaluating? Nothing at all. Nothing at all. Now, I find that A Course in Miracles, which is by Jesus, and Longchenpa's work, which is beautifully encapsulated in this book, Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen Lhasa Heart, Longchenpa's Precious Treasure, the Dharma Dhatu, translated and commentary by Keith Dauman. I find these two extraordinarily complementary. This beautiful Dzogchen, Radical Dzogchen, and A Course in Miracles are so complementary. They're saying the same thing, but they complement one another by the particular styles that they have. So each one helps clarify the other. It's this mutually beneficial situation that actually is taking place here. So I was reading Spaciousness last night and today, and it was just tremendous. It is just tremendous. I mean, we're listening to one of the greatest teachers ever here in Longchenpa. There's no question about it. Just the same as A Course in Miracles, we're listening to one of the greatest teachers ever in Jesus Christ. There's no doubt about it. Both of them are in this echelon, like great pizza. You know, you just like, well, both places are great. Speaking of that, here's another antidote. I'm sort of a pizza aficionado, as many of us are. You know, I've eaten pizza at many, 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 many different places, and I'm always looking and say, well, you know, where's the ultimate pizza? Is there one that's better? Recently, I found one, and it's just great. It is just absolutely tremendous. And then someone else told me, said, yeah, I also know about that pizza, and it's really good. But there's another place that's also just as good, and maybe even better. And he told me where it was, and I went there. We went there last night, Sunday night, after church. And son of a gun, if it wasn't true, this pizza was just fabulous. Just, my gosh. So now I know two great pizza places. That's pretty good knowledge, right? Two great pizza places. we're really brilliant here, aren't we? And so do I say, well, you know, which is better? No, they're both outstanding. When something's outstanding, you don't throw it into a comparison game. That's just stupidity. They're both outstanding. One's a thin crust, one with a puffed up edge, and the other's a thick crust pizza. So one doesn't have any tomato marinara, whatever, and the other has some tomato sauce on it. And they're stylistic differences, but they both are absolutely delicious. And so Jesus Christ and Longchamp are like that. They're both absolutely delicious from a spiritual standpoint. It's like food, delicious food, delicious spiritual pizza for our spirits. And we benefit greatly from listening to either one of them. Absolutely benefit greatly. You cannot go wrong putting your attention on either one of these great teachers. And I'm thrilled to be associated with both of them and be able to draw attention to both of these fabulous, fabulous teachers who are pointing us towards the truth. That pure spaciousness cannot be compounded in any way. And so, with that, we will try and read another chapter. I'm always kind of not sure if I can do it because it's so profound that I don't know if I can do it justice at all. I don't even pretend that I can do it justice, but just the very act of at least reading this, I believe, has some benefit here. All thanks to Longchenpa. I do believe he is somehow present with us and helping us out. I have more corroboration of this belief actually took place yesterday. And he's more than capable of helping us out in some way. So we will keep trying to become familiar with what is being said. Now, my commentary would differ a little bit from Keith Thomas' commentary, just like stylistically pizza differs from one to the other. Yeah, I have this perspective from A Course in Miracles that I bring to Dzogchen. Okay, so I would have a little different viewpoint on it, but it's fine. The commentary is beautiful and heartfelt, and the intent is all there and has many wonderful things to say. But I'm going to focus on what Longchenpa has to say here. In Canto 2, Buddha Fields. The spaciousness that is pristine spontaneity pervades everything, joining outside and inside. It has no boundaries, top or bottom, and is beyond direction. As pure presence, it is clear like the sky, non-spatial, non-dual, as the vast matrix itself, it is beyond pulsating thought and image. The magical illusion that emanates within this unborn spaciousness, quite indeterminate, without any definition whatsoever, cannot be denominated as something, for it has no substance or attribute. Insofar as its sky-like nature fills space-time, it is unborn spontaneity, no before or after, no beginning or end. The nature of all samsara and nirvana is this luminous mind, unmanifest, unproduced, indeterminate spontaneity, coming from nowhere and going nowhere. The matrix of luminous mind indicates neither past nor future, for it is unvarying in its all-pervasive uniformity. Reality, just as it is, without beginning, middle, or end, an all-pervasive smoothness, is sky-like in nature, without either beginning or end, supersedes linear time. Without origination or cessation, it can have neither substance nor attribute. It is invariable, so it cannot be denominated as anything. It cannot be induced or practiced, so nothing is to be done, and without mass or volume, it is the ground of suchness. Unimaginable and unassailable is the matrix of sameness. Since sameness is the reality of all things, everything necessarily rests in the matrix of sameness. This luminous mind is a singularity in which all is equal. And since its all-pervasive smoothness is like unmanifest space, within that gamut of sameness, there can be no intervention. This fortress of non-temporal spontaneity, all-pervasive, this fortress of the vast matrix of the now, without top, bottom, or middle, this fortress of the unborn Dharmakaya, impartially all-accommodating, this fortress of the precious secret that is unchanging spontaneity, this fortress of the now, the entire galaxy, samsara and nirvana, this is the totality, the single denominator. Upon a zero-dimensional, all-pervasive foundation stands the palace of luminous mind, samsara and nirvana identical. At its marvelously high pinnacle in the vast matrix of reality, the center of an uncreated omnidimensional panorama, a wide open doorway to freedom from graduated endeavor. Within that palace, arrayed with spontaneously amassed wealth, the king, self-sprung awareness, takes his throne. His pulsating projections, emanations of his pristine awareness, serve as ministers who govern his domain. The Holy Queen, innate meditative absorption, attends. With spontaneous guru vision, her offspring and her servants, all centered in the pure pleasure matrix of intrinsic, non-conceptual clarity. Within that still, ineffable plenum, the King masters all manifest and potential appearances, and the immense dominion of vast spaciousness is his. Living in that land, everything is Dharmakaya, never straying from our unitary self-sprung awareness in the now, seizing the uncreated now beyond striving and practice, encompassed by the one soul sphere that has no hard edges. Just as we are centered in that undifferentiated, all-inclusive matrix. Since the six mythic realms and even the Buddha fields shine nowhere but in that sky-like reality, in that inherently clear luminous mind, they are of one taste, and samsara and nirvana are naturally assimilated to pure presence. In this treasury of existential spaciousness, the universal source, nirvana, unsought, is the constant spontaneity of the now. So given the Dharmakaya as unchanging, non-referential, all-investing, internal and external visions, all life forms are the Sambhogakaya. And the Nirmanakaya is like naturally occurring reflection. So all experience necessarily ornamenting the three kayas, it is all empty, physical, energetic, and mental display. And the countless Buddha fields, likewise, without exception, all arise from the same source, the nature of mind, the Trikaya matrix. The contents of samsara, the six realms and their inhabitants, also, surely, are mere reflections within intrinsic spaciousness. All the phantasmagoria of life and death, pleasure and pain, like apparitional show, abound in the matrix of mind in itself, apparent yet insubstantial and hence truly non-existent. It occurs through adventitious circumstance, like moisture condensing as clouds, neither existent nor non-existent, beyond determinate extremes. It is all included in the one soul sphere where nothing is elaborated. The nature of mind, the essential luminous mind, pure like the sky, free of birth and death, pleasure and pain, unaffected by materiality, is indifferent to samsara and nirvana. It cannot be indicated as something, for it is a vast sky-like matrix, unchanging and incapable of sublimation, It is unalloyed spontaneity. Buddha lies in the Vajra heart that is clear light, where everything is fields of self-sprung bliss, everything the unremitting sameness of that supreme light. So we're just doing our practicing here, getting familiar with this transmission, getting familiar with it. I read some of this today. I was waiting, had to wait somewhere, and so I'd started reading it, and I was struck by certain sentences, and I just had to stop. I was just struck by, oh my gosh, the sameness, right, the sameness of everything. Why can't we see that, the sameness of everything? Why do we have to keep trying to see differences in terms of compoundment? We think, well, this is compounded pure spaciousness this way, and this is compounded it that way, and which compoundment do we like, which compoundment we do prefer, which one we don't, what we like, when in fact there isn't any compoundment. There's not a part of pure spaciousness that is compounded with some other part, as Longchamp is pointing out. That is not possible. It's this absolute smoothed out sameness, seamless, smoothed out sameness. And he again and again, he approaches it from many angles. What he's getting at is it cannot be compounded. And this spontaneity he talks about is the fact that nothing has to happen first for anything to arise, because there is no compoundment that has to be undone. There's no compoundment that has to take place. There's no residue of anything happening as far as building or unbuilding. There's no trace. It's traceless. There's no trace of it ever happening. There's nothing getting in the way that has to happen first for appearance to arise. So this is the term spontaneity. It happens instantly, effortlessly, right now, in the now, because nothing has to happen prior to that at all. And the pristineness is speaking about that no matter what arises, it never compounds or crystallizes. So this pure, clear light, this vast sky-like matrix, never changes. It always remains exactly the same it is. So it's pristine. It's pristine. It's always pristine spontaneity. This is something he returns to again and again and again and again. So I find myself with a deeper appreciation of this and relating to it better and better. I think it's been several years now since I purchased this book. I purchased it in November 4th of 2013. So it's been a little over 2 years. And it certainly is seeming clearer and clearer and clearer what he's getting at. And I'm appreciating it more and more. It's not some like fuzzy, like, what in the world is he talking about? I understand what he's getting at. He's pointing out to us just a very simple truth here, but he's able to keep reinforcing it in beautiful ways, really beautiful ways that help us out. But we're really just saying pure spaciousness cannot be compounded at all. There's no compoundment anywhere, actually. Doesn't exist. That's why there's a sameness everywhere. There's no compoundment at all. So everything is just mere appearance. There isn't any world or things or forms actually as anything crystallized or compounded in the slightest bit. Doesn't exist. So there's this fundamental truth. Now, graduated endeavor, what he's getting at there, I see as meaning, well, trying to get to drop each of these evaluations one by one by one by one by one. This is never going to work. So our aim is to set it all down at once. This is our aim. This is the aim of A Course in Miracles too. That doesn't mean that we don't gradually get familiar with this, with the idea of setting it down altogether and gradually get used to the wow of it and evaporate the continuity fear. That does take place gradually because we have massive resistance to this, which keeps pushing us onto graduated endeavor. So getting off of graduated endeavor is itself graduated. So this has to be realized. Just because we say, oh, graduated endeavor, eventually we'll get it, and I'm seeing it better and better now. Like, oh yeah, trying to evaluate nothing is useless. It's futile. There's no reason to not just set it all down at once, because it has no value whatsoever. Zero. Just set it down all at once. This is what he's getting at. It is, you have to set it down all at once. And this is what we're focusing on, yes. But the resistance to this, the wow around, like, wow, I can do this. Wow, I'm going to do this. It's tremendous wow around this. And so we have to get familiar. Familiarity is still, pragmatically, that's what's decisive for us. Otherwise, teachers would just not teach anything. Say, "Oh, I mean, by very active teaching, I'm inducing graduated effort or something." Of course, that's foolish. But so the point about graduated effort is, the mind's belief says, "Oh my gosh, you mean I have to individually set down each of these evaluations? I've been doing that. It's going to take forever." Thinking that that has to do it this way. No. Seeing that again, all evaluation of meaninglessness is itself meaningless. It doesn't, there's not a quantity of value there at all to be setting down, to set down. So this will gradually dawn upon us. It's dawning upon me now, which is why I'm able to understand what Longchamp is getting at, much more simpatico with the understanding and recognition and acceptance of it. It's starting to dawn on me, like, oh. And I did have that dream where this massive concrete block, the entire center, the whole entire center just disappeared instantly, leaving just the periphery. That's it. This is a dream symbolizing setting it, all this evaluating down. Jesus calls it thinking. Because your problem is your thinking. I would say the problem is our evaluating. We're trying to evaluate relative value. We're trying to see relative value, where in absolute there's actually no value at all. In the illusions of compoundment, there isn't any compoundment to evaluate. So we're saying, well, which illusions are, you know, more do I prefer over the others? And the there's no compoundment at all. So these illusions are all equally untrue. And this is what Jesus gets at in Course in Miracles over and over and over and over and over. All illusions are equally untrue. Don't try to evaluate. Try to find some value in illusions. This is our problem. So you could say that Jesus is a radical Dzogchen master too. In A Course in Miracles, this is absolutely, you know, spectacularly beautiful Dzogchen. And you might say Longchamp is a Course in Miracles adept, because what he's saying is, you know, wonderfully similar to what Jesus has to say. They're both getting to the very same issue of setting it all down at once. All illusions of compoundment. All at once. Setting them down. Gently setting aside. And of course, the Holy Spirit has imagines for us whatever we need to so that we don't, our continuity fear doesn't become too severe. Say, wait, you know, I'm setting everything down. I'm so used to have this continuity issue, and I don't want to be entirely, you know, without anything at all that I'm used to, that kind of situation. So the Holy Spirit does have our back on this, absolutely. So we can practice without fear. If this wasn't the case, we would be too frightened. We think, oh my gosh, if I keep going, I'm going to set, I'm just going to experience pure spaciousness and nothing else, and the universe will just vanish for a minute, and I don't need it anymore, and, you know, on and on and on. There's all these kind of fears. Jesus says the Holy Spirit has imagined a real world for us, actually, to take the place of this, to help us with our continuity fear, to the final aspects of it, to help that out. Anyway, we're looking here at this, and so I can say with certainty now that if 2 years of hindsight, considering what Longchamp has to say, I can definitely see progress with what I've done. There's no question about it. There's been a great deal of progress to assimilating what he has to say, and feeling more and more comfortable with it. Tremendous progress has taken place. So, just because you hear it, you say, "I'm not quite sure what he's saying," so it's the effort to hear it and get familiar with it and keep working with it and keep trying. This absolutely will produce progress, but it will be seen mostly in hindsight. Going back now and looking at it again, I haven't read this for quite some time. I find it's much easier for me now to read it, and much less feeling of confusion or resistance or whatever, and just say, yeah, this is it, this is true. And, you know, the stylistic differences, I just brush them aside in terms of setting it into a Buddhist context, into Tibetan Buddhist context, and the various terminologies. It doesn't matter. That's not important. He's really just pointing to a very simple truth, that pure spaciousness cannot be compounded. And it's the base of all, therefore. I mean, there is no way it can be changed. It never loses its pure, pristine spontaneity. Never. And so everything always arises out of that as mere apparitional, magical show, emanation of appearances and play. But it never strays one iota from the pure spaciousness that it is, that it actually is, like a reflection, a creative reflection for just sheer enjoyment. How are we doing? Pretty good. Okay. Now, today, November 30th, Climate Change Conference in Paris has started. And the future of this planet, keep in mind that the top-down bureaucracies, the powers that be in this world, have a 15-year plan for the next 15 years of this planet. They already have this very detailed blueprint with massive power behind it to pursue this blueprint and use technology to the utmost to try and reach the goals of this blueprint. And it's for 15 years, and it's already set in stone. And so we should be asking ourselves, are these how we want to spend the next 15 years? Is it for, you know, being set in stone, set to the, you know, the grist for the mill of this agenda? Because this is the agenda that the world is going into, short of certain catastrophes, etc., which may very well happen. This is the agenda that we're looking at. So we say, hey, wait a minute, not so fast here. I don't think many of us realize that the social engineers of this planet have a very detailed plan, and they've announced their plan to the world. They've described it very clearly as United Nations Agenda 21, 17 Sustainable Development Goals, and it's for 15 years, and they are going to implement this, and it's going to affect every single person on this planet, basically. And so I really feel very few people are aware of this. If they were, they might say, hey, wait a minute, let's see, do we have an option? We have some option? Well, yes, we do. Working on non-dual abidance is an option. Acceptance that pure spaciousness cannot be compounded in any way is definitely going to open the door wide open, as Longchenpa says, wide open door, wide open for us. And our options, we may realize, wow, we have quite a few options. We have a tremendous options that we weren't aware of, actually. And they're not necessarily Agenda 21 options. Not that we're trying to attack those sustainable development goals. I think a lot of those goals are well-intentioned and well-meaning, and those who want to go in that direction, you know, they go in that direction if that's what they want. It may have unintended consequences. It may end up feeling like, hey, this isn't, what am I really doing? Is this life? Well, trying to change reality, is that life that God intended? Is that the life that God intended for us to spend our efforts and our experiencing in attempt to change reality, which is exactly what we're trying to do here with this training program of imperilment, really, which is what this whole planet and bodies are all about, imperilment, trying to develop a way to change what we are. That's what we're engaged in. That's not really the life that God created us for. We're not really happy with it at all. And yet we're caught in this continuity fear. So we keep thinking, if we just don't pay attention to the continuity fear, maybe it'll go away. Maybe it'll go away. And if you really look at the issue of continuity fear, you realize it can't go away just by ignoring it. It's not possible. That just makes it stronger. You have to realize that we're used to trying to change what we are. And now we have to get used to not trying to change what we are in a scenario of non-imperilment. Non-imperilment. Now, certainly when we realize that nothing is compounded, we realize nothing can be imperiled at all, because there isn't anything, actually. It's just all light. It's just all the appearancing of light. So, it's a very profound realization. I like the idea of the sameness, and just why can't we see everything just being the same, having this shared sameness, a shared sameness in relation to pure spaciousness. I found that very agreeable to me. I said, yeah, that's what I want. This is how I want to see. I also asked the Holy Spirit for help. I don't want to see bodies anymore. And Jesus says that there's a vision where you don't see bodies anymore. You don't need to. Because what are bodies, really? You start looking into it and you start recognizing, wow. And I've made some progress on that the last 24 hours, actually, which is very good. I'm so tired of seeing bodies. I just don't want to see bodies anymore. Because that has nothing to do with what we are. Absolutely nothing to do with what we are. It just means that someone is still believing in imperilment and trying to change reality, and they're trying to evaluate different forms of nothing or different illusions, trying to evaluate illusions, which is not necessary. There's no reason to see bodies, because their bodies are illusions too. And I realized today that, you know, sensory experience is the body is itself an illusion of compoundment. And so we're believing in an illusion of compoundment, telling us that there is compoundment, you know, commenting on other illusions of compoundment. How reliable is that evidence? It's totally unreliable. Our senses just are a reaction mechanism. It's the mind that's interpreting everything, and the mind is saying, oh, the body is seeing compoundment. There must be compoundment. But the body itself is an illusion of compoundment. So how reliable, again, can an illusion of compoundment testimony be but that it's claiming it's seeing compoundment? That's ridiculous. So the senses cannot be relied to see, cannot see the fact that there's no compoundment at all. Body itself is just an illusion of compoundment. There is no compoundment. Pure spaciousness is not being compounded. Pure spacious is seamlessly both in outside and inside. There's no gap. It's not like we're putting an outside spaciousness together with the inside spaciousness and then we have one spaciousness. No, there's never any gap in the pure spaciousness. There's never any gap there at all. There's never been any gap. There's never been any compoundment. I am the authority of now. There's only one authority. And that's the I am now authority. There isn't any other authority at all. There isn't any other authority at all. Fear doesn't have any authority whatsoever. I am at home now. Fear is a stranger here. Fear is the stranger here with no authority. I am the one authority. I am the one authority of now. The uncompoundedness, which is the nowness. It's uncompounded with no past, future, or middle to it. There's no compoundment. It's seamless in every which way. So it's not like we have to get rid of some compoundment that happened. Oh, there's some darkness. Darkness compounded. Pure spaciousness. I got to lighten the darkness up. There's never been a compoundment, however you want to try and imagine some illusion of it. So we don't have to defeat anything. Say, oh, there's that terrible fixation. I've got to destroy that fixation of darkness. There isn't any fixation. There's no compoundment. There's no crystallization. And therefore, there's nothing that's ever been undone from crystallization. So there's no residue or trace of any undoing whatsoever. So it's pristine, pristine spontaneity. It's pristine spacious, immaculately pristine spaciousness. This is the real term, the Immaculate Virgin. This is what it really refers to. Jesus born of the Immaculate Virgin means spirit is born into pure spaciousness. That's what it's really alluding to. Absolute pristine nature, which is ever virginal, right? This is what the Catholicism, Christianity, the symbolism, we've lost it, the symbolism of it, as we have become more and more materialistic, fascinated by illusions of a compoundment. We have lost the deep symbology of Christianity. The Immaculate Virgin, Jesus born of the Immaculate Virgin, means our spirits are all appearancing, all experiencing arises in this pristine, all-pervasive field of pristine spontaneity, this sky-like matrix of pure, clear light that is ever virginal, ever immaculate, no trace of anything being born or not born in it. Okay, it doesn't change through arising and dissipating, and everything that happens in it does not compromise the what it is in the slightest bit. No compoundment ever takes place. So I don't know if I've ever heard anyone explain it, Christianity this way, the Virgin Mary and Jesus this way, but this is what it's really getting at. It's very profound, actually, Christianity, if we were to understand it, but our understanding of it is falling to pieces as works are being emphasized. We had a our pastor, our priest, parochial priest, or the parochial vicar, whatever you want to call it, associate priest, not the head one, but the associate, gave us very good homily, and it was after the Pope had emphasized works as being so super important, and the homily was about from St. James or something, saying how faith without works is dead, is dead. And so he started going into it, but then he completely reversed it, and he says, hey, listen, works without faith is just as equally dead, if not more so. And so he preached an opposite homily to what the direction of Catholicism is going. And I compliment him afterwards. I said, that was really tremendous what you did. Well, we haven't heard of him since. It's very interesting. We just commented. We haven't seen him in 2 months. He's not giving homilies anymore. They put him on some sort of project, building project or something. I hadn't thought of that until just this moment. He had the guts and the grace to speak up and say, hey, wait a minute, we're overemphasizing works. That was his whole homily. He says, we are overemphasizing works. And that was about the last time we heard of him. We commented yesterday, said, where is he? Where is he? He hasn't been given mass at all. What happened to him? And I saw him outside one day, and I said, they're keeping you real busy, huh? And he looked at me, and he said, he laughed and shook his head, and says, like, you don't know the half of it, maybe I'm going to have to talk with him, see what's going on. But that shows you, I don't know what happened, but maybe it can be connected to the homily he gave. We're way overemphasizing works in the world. Drastic overemphasis of it, which is why I speak out on the Pope and, or the ex-Pope, because I excommunicated him, which a friend of Jesus, an apostle of Jesus, has every right to speak up on these issues. And he's not being a good shepherd. He's overemphasizing works, which is contributing to this massive, massive decline in proper understanding of what Catholicism and what Jesus, Christianity is really about. The worshiping of the Virgin Mary as this mother goddess is very much inappropriate. And on and on and on and on and on. This is a misunderstanding. And the idea of the two natures, a human and divine and Jesus, and the hypostatic union of all this. It's on and on and on. There's been all sorts of mistakes made. Instead of correcting those mistakes, going back to understanding what is the faith based upon, we're going now into this hell of just good works, and which then fits the agenda of the materialist perfectly. So they love it. They say, oh, I love it. It's wonderful. Finally, we're hearing what we want to hear from Christianity. It's a disaster. It's a spiritual disaster. And since Jesus is already back in this world, he's the authority now in this world, and I'm aware of this, and a good friend of Jesus. That's why I excommunicated the Pope. I said he's Pope Emeritus now, because he's not sending the church in the right. He's not shepherding in the right direction. He's shepherding them right into the wolf's den, actually. But I don't have anything personally against him. But oh, I think he's probably a wonderful person, and we probably get along with him very well. But we're talking about pragmatic issue here. It's not a personal issue. It's a pragmatic issue. We have to have a much more enlightened understanding of what the symbology of Christianity is, and it's really right in line with radical Dzogchen. Absolutely, it is. And I think Longchenpa probably is pointing out Christianity better than about any Christian has ever pointed it out, other than Jesus, actually. If you listen to what he's saying, you could say he's a true Christian. He's explaining that the ever-virginal nature of pure spaciousness as the all-embracing matrix from which everything emanates from, and it never loses its quality from no matter how much emanation or non-emanation takes place. And this is the heart of all truth. This is the heart of all truth. This is therefore the heart of what Jesus came to tell us as well. And there's a lot of symbology that was used in Christianity, and it's very symbolic. And people had much clearer understanding of the symbology back then than they do now. Now the people are really, it's just an institution that is just giving this false sense of sophistication to people who come there. And but there are priests, there are priests who are trying, no question. They realize there's something deeper to it, but they get squelched. They get our parochial vicar, parochial priesthood got he retired early, took early retirement. He's another one that tried to slip in the truth to us. So they want just a, they want priests who just toe the line of the whole, of the Vatican, basically, in my opinion, from what I'm seeing, which is a disaster. There's more and more control being put over bishops and what the message is, and as this climate control issue comes center stage, as the Pope is putting it, sees that's the most important issue for Christians worldwide, Catholics worldwide, everybody, then more and more and more there's going to be demand that everybody toe the line towards works. And they will be pushing out these priests and bishops, who they have ways of doing this, who are trying to say, hey, wait a minute, faith is really, really important here. Let's clarify what is our faith based upon. What is our faith based upon? This is severe ignorance of this right now. Crushing ignorance. And yet, we have these helpers. We have these helpers. As again, I call Longchamp a true Christian, a true great Christian, delivering the message of salvation in his own style, saying exactly the same as what Jesus Christ is saying, and saying it beautifully and helpfully. And Tibetan Buddhists might call Jesus Christ a true radical Dzogchen master as well. They might call him that, which is fine. That's a compliment as well. Absolutely. Absolutely it is. This is very wowish here, what's being said. Of course, this is the whole idea. Taking on the power structures of this world like this. What else could we do? You know, false sophistication in an attempt to convince ourselves we don't really need to do the work that needs to be done is not the right path to go down. And then keep trying to tell yourself by doing works that you're somehow, you don't need to do this other. I mean, there's nothing wrong with works, but works without faith is dead, sterile. And meaning you have to do the evaporate, have faith in evaporating the continuity fear and practicing non-dual abidance, that it will dawn upon you. The uncompounded nature of reality will dawn upon us. And this is true liberation. Abiding in non-dual, in non-dual awareness is true liberation. We have to have faith in that. And if we just put all our effort into works, feeding the poor, you know, clothing, you know, them doing good works, and that's all we're doing, this isn't going to work for anyone. But again, I want to emphasize that I highly appreciate all the charity work that everyone does, and this is very good too. It is helpful. It's not detrimental, but I would say faith is paramount. Is paramount, and faith that this tough work in evaporating the continuity fear is the way to go, and it will work. This is absolutely paramount. Without this, we're just going to go into a socialist, dystopian, materialistic situation, which we're already hell-bent on that. And that should seem to quote-unquote crystallize about July of 2016. And people would just say, well, this is it. Now, how come we didn't see this before? Like that. How come we didn't see that this is the answer? They will have lost their faith. They will have lost their faith. There's an incredible loss of faith taking place in this world. And this is why it's so difficult. It's been so difficult for me to keep going so I can speak like this. I've had to work at it every single day of my life because there's this massive falling away of genuine faith in the world, and it's being diverted into avenues of futility, actually. So, Longchenpa, what does he say? Well, reality cannot be compounded. This bit pure space just cannot be compounded. Cannot, never can, never is, never can, and that's it, basically. And so it's not like we need to be intimidated by these teachers. What they have to say is very simple. It's just that they help us kind of look at it from different attractive ways, so our attention keeps being drawn back to this simple fact, and so it doesn't get stale to us. So he has a lot of ways of saying, hey, this is the truth, this is the truth, this is the truth, this is the truth, this is the truth. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful ways of putting it, Longchenpa, really, really unsurpassed, is in terms of just, again, others can also do the same, but they reach this level of, this is just fabulous pizza. It's fabulous pizza what he's doing. There's no question about it. And that's what we want. That's what we want. It's very helpful. Just as music to our spiritual ears, actually. Of course, our continuity fear will kind of bristle, like, whoa, what is this? But we understand when we identify this is our problem, guess what? Our continuity fear doesn't bristle as much. And it really, there's some part within us that's saying, thank you so much for working on this. I know I'm a problem for you, but I'm glad you're evaporating me. So I'm going to try to work with you as much as I can. There's a turnaround within ourselves, and we become less conflicted within. There's a trust, inner trust that builds up. And again, the benefit is hindsight that I have now. And hindsight is very powerful. How do you get hindsight? You have to work at it diligently, right? Every day ultimately builds up hindsight. This is, what I've done, and I have hindsight on it, and I can see, what the effect has been. If we don't put any effort into it, how can we get hindsight on what we've been working on? If we're not working on anything, how can we get hindsight? You cannot. And hindsight helps our faith. It's very important. I don't know anybody who can go from a severe delusion in belief in compoundment to simply snapping their fingers and realizing nothing has ever been compounded and abide in that forevermore. I've never heard of any such an instance ever taking place. And Jesus says that theoretically it's possible, but in pragmatically, the most you can say is that it would be, the rarest of rarities for anything like such for that to happen. Rarest of rarities. And so it's pragmatically, it's a zero to think about that. It's a zero. So of course we have to work at this, getting used to the idea that, hey, nothing's ever been compounded. There is no compoundment. There is no thingness, actually. There is no determinateness, actually. As Jesus says, all is perfect freedom. Right now, right here, right now. Not in my mind, I would say everything's perfect. What are you talking about? Problems? Nothing. There's no problems. Everything's perfect right now. Reality is flawlessly present right here, right now. It's not compounded. There's nothing we need to do to uncompound it. This is what Longchenpa is talking about, of graduated effort. What do you do? Graduated effort for what? What do we need to do to get rid of? Oh, we got to get rid of this compoundment. I thought this was compounded, but it's not. But now these other ones, I got to work on uncompounding them, maybe. And okay, I uncompounded that. Nothing's ever been compounded. There's nothing that needs to be uncompounded. And again, we're just getting familiar with this, and familiarity works. This is what I'm saying, familiarity works. 2 years of letting this sink in, getting familiar, letting it sink in. Now I go back to it and say, ah, I'm much more familiar with it now. It seems much easier than before. It doesn't seem strange. It doesn't seem mystically strange, or it just seems like matter of fact. It's just matter of fact. It's just very matter of factly telling us the truth about reality. That's all. Nothing esoteric or quaint about it, or, you know, foreign or odd or super complicated. Nothing like that. It's very, very simple truth. That's all. So, I consider him a brother in Christ, absolutely. As he would, maybe he considers a brother, a fellow Buddha mind, yeah, right? It's all pointing to the same truth. Reality, there's no compoundment taking place. Jesus says, each moment is completely free of every other moment. Absolutely, completely free. There's no carryover from one moment to the next. Zero, zero, zero. Exactly the same what Longchenpa is saying here. Using slightly different terminology, slightly different style, so, right? It's exactly the same though. And this is the truth. This is the truth. And we're just getting used to hearing this, hearing it. It's extraordinary truth, isn't it? It's not something that we're used to hearing at all. So we have this extreme familiarity problem, or continuity problem. Extreme continuity problem here is getting worse with this materialism and this emphasis on works. It's making it much, 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 much worse than before. And we're becoming, false sophisticates, actually. The world's very much into false sophistication of dabbling in certain spiritual terminology, and then thinking that means, oh, I don't need to really look at this continuity issue. That's just, you know, something that's, I'm already high up there. I'm already sophisticated. I don't need to be any more sophisticated. I've done enough. this stuff is just window, most of the world is just window dressing. The efforts that are being made are just window dressing. That's all it is. They don't get down to the real work at all. This is my report to Jesus. They don't get down to the real work at all, Jesus here. They're thinking that computers will do it for them, you know. Really, artificial intelligence. Think, oh, finally, I thought I had to do all this tough work, and now computers will just crunch the numbers for me. You know, crunch the compoundments for me, do the evaluating of all this compoundments for me, and come up with the answer, so I can just kind of, you know, vegetate and go shopping, go shopping. Which is becoming more and more an obsession in the world. I just spoke with somebody. Who did I speak with? Oh my gosh, yeah. They said, how do they like coming over here to the United States? This, that, they said, oh, they're just shopping fiends. All they do is shop. That's all they do is shop. These young girls just shop, shopping fiends. This is what people are into right now. And I've been through this. And believe me, I put the grace of God put me through all these various experiencings so I'd be available at this time. So I've already worked through it all. So I went through a long phase of being a shopaholic, for sure. So I know exactly what it's like to be caught up in being a shopaholic. That was an addiction. I went into that addiction to find out, what is this like? I went into various addictions consciously and said, okay, I'm going to go through this, and then I know I'm going to have to get free of it, and let's see what this is like. Is this an answer? Is this it? How bad is it? How severe? Can we get free of it? Everybody's saying here, no, we're stuck. We can't get free of our addictions. Well, this is not true, because I've intentionally became addicted to all sorts of stuff and then got free of all of it, got free of it. So we can get free of all our addictions. Absolutely, we can. I tell the story of arachnophobia. I had one of the worst cases of that. Imagine, I know someone else who has a case like that. A number of people, it's quite fairly common, arachnophobia. And it was ruining my life. And I realized, I said, okay, it's time to break this fear. This is silly. I cannot go on the rest of my life with this, and I'm going to beat this fear. There's no question about it. And it took me about a year to do it. But I did it. I did it. I did it. I did it. I was working in this place today with all sorts of spiders all over the place. I was just like, just brush them aside here. I don't really love spiders, really. I don't know too many people that do. But the arachnophobia is gone. It's eradicated, arachnicated. It's not there anymore. So, what I want to show the world is these addictions that people have. We can get free of them if we decide this is what we're going to do. We absolutely can get free of these addictions. And we need to, we should, we should, we should, we should. We don't want our lives just governed by all this stuff. Governed by, this world is essentially just a massive Pandora's box of addictions. Cornucopia or whatever you want to call it. Just there's so many addictions. Everybody has these various addictions, and we think, oh, this is life. This life, this addiction is life. No, it's not. It's a diversion from working on what we need to work on. It's all these are diversions, so we don't practice. And we say, well, I can't practice. I'm addicted. This is another thing I get a lot of. So, oh, yeah, I'm really addicted with this. I got so many problems in there. I can't. I can't practice. First, I have to beat this addiction. Well, one of the best ways to beat these addictions is to start practicing. And then you realize you enjoy this is better, you like this better than your addiction. And you also realize that your addiction was telling you that you can't do this, and you're just proving it wrong. You say, well, say the addiction, you were wrong, you were mistaken, I can do this. But the only way to get over these addictions is to prove to yourself that you can focus on truth and practice evaporating continuity fear and practicing towards non-dual abidance. You can do it. You have to prove to yourself you can do it. Otherwise, the addictions will keep laughing at you and mocking you. Addictions are terrible. I know. I've been there, done that, experienced many, many different types of addictions. They're terrible. It's horrible. They mock you. They mock you. They mock you. And you just feel in the grip of them like you're nothing. You have no will. You can't do it. They keep mocking you. And again, all of these are just the purpose of diverting us from right spiritual practice. That's it. Because continuity fear is so strong, telling us, oh no, we need to change what we are. If we don't do this, God will annihilate us. And we think, oh, I got to do this, I got to do this. How do I keep trying to do this? Let me get this addiction, this will help, Let me be addicted to suffering. Let me be addicted to misery. Can't get free of it. I can't get free of it. But this is all you have to do is recognize, hey, continuity fear can be evaporated in a gradual way, evaporating it, so we don't get catapulted into full awareness of reality, the uncompoundedness, but not catapulted into complete pure realization of zero compoundedness, and just and like that, we're not catapulted into it like that. That we were able to evaporate the continuity fear so much that the idea of setting all this evaluating down all at once, it no longer seems to be such a frightening thing. I just was considering, I said, yeah, that'd be great. I'd love to do that. There's really hardly any fear at all arose around it. But that's because I'm gradually worked at evaporating the continuity fear by constantly listening to truth, listening to truth, considering truth, coming up with practices all the time, coming up with some practice that's helpful practice, and keep working on that practice. This is how it's done. So, see everything is saying this? Yeah, I'm all for it. That's great. There's no leap of terror inside of me, really. There isn't. There's a wow. There's some wow around this. Like, wow. There's no terror around this. And that produces a wow. Like, wow, I don't have any fear about this. Wow. That's a huge wow. So success breeds the wow, right? And so, as I say, we have to manage our success on the path. It's absolutely critical. We manage our success. Be aware that the wow is arising to, all All the time, the wow is arising as we make progress here. And instead of getting saying, oh, I can't make any success, just realize, no, I'm in the wow of having made tremendous success, and I've just realized I'm going to make even more, and that produces even more wow. So I need to just be patient with myself. There's this patience. We need to be patient. Don't try to be this superstar of I need to succeed, because that one doesn't work. Be patient and humble, and keep stay in the wow, full stop in the wow as much as possible. How are we doing? Okay. Chilly again. Chilly, California. We have really flipped the script here, the climate script here. There's no global warming here right now. It's cold. This is as cold as I can ever remember November. Wow. As the last 4 years were as warm as I could, warmer than I can ever remember November. It's like summertime. Pretty much the whole year was like, it's been like summer for 4 years. But this is back to the raw feeling of cloudy coldness and wind and just chilly, bone chilling feeling and all of that stuff. We're not really used to that. We've gotten spoiled. I wish it would just rain. Come on, we don't need clear coldness or cloudy coldness. We need rain, 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 rain. Let it rain. Come on. Enough of this coldness. Let it rain. So it is go time. It is go time. We know it's go time. We expect great help at this point. I'll do what I can to help out. Hopefully what I can do to help out is substantial. I don't know at this point. I don't know just how much continuity fear is left in me. This is something I don't try to measure. I just keep working on it. It seems to be very difficult to measure. I don't advise trying to measure it. Just keep working on it. It seems to be quite deep, runs quite deep in us, more deeper than we know, right? Deeper than we know, which is why so many shy away from it. They say, uh-oh, I think that's going to be too much work. Let me go take this posturing of being a spiritual sophisticate. Let me posture that way. I don't want to have to deal with this continuity fear, and maybe I can convince it that I'm so sophisticated that I don't really have to deal with this kind of stuff. It's beneath me. This is the attitude of the world, the lazy ones who are trying to avoid the work that has to be done. So they may have the Gemini 21 may have the 15-year plan. We have the 7-month plan right here. And in December, January, February, March, April, May, and June, the 7-month plan. We're in the 7-month plan. I don't know what can be done. We're going to find out. I might try something. I don't know what's indicated, but the will, with the grace of the Holy Spirit, something will happen that we can. There are some in the world who have worked hard at the spiritual path, really, really hard at it, right? Well, those are the ones that are going to benefit from this time now and should benefit from it, and they have every right to ask for help. They don't want to get pulled down into works, excessive works, and thinking this is the answer. Nothing needs to be undone. Nothing needs to be done. Nothing needs to be undone. Comes from Jesus in Longchamp. Jesus says, I need do nothing. He says, ultimately you realize, I need do nothing. I need do nothing. Because there's nothing that's compounded. Nothing needs to be undone. Nothing needs to be cleaned up. Nothing needs to be fixed. Nothing needs to be, you know, changed. Nothing has to happen there. Nothing needs to be done. The reality is still perfect. This perfect super matrix of reality, of pure spaciousness, is perfect. It's flawless. Nothing has to be done. Everything is arising exactly as it's always arisen, out of the pristine spontaneity, and not compromising this pristine spontaneity in the slightest bit. Fully released in the now, intrinsically, always intrinsically fully released in the now. The now accepts its arising and accepts its subsiding equally, flawlessly, without any change in what it is. It never leaves the pure nature of reality in the slightest bit. Nothing ever does. There's nothing to be undone, no compounding to be undone. For me, Longchenpa doesn't have any baggage. I don't have any baggage concerning. Just someone's pointing out the truth. I don't really have any baggage at all. So it's different with Jesus Christ for most people. They have the long Judeo-Christian tradition and heritage and church and lots of lots and lots and lots and lots of stuff and conflict and everything. I think it's more difficult for people to just hang out with Jesus. I'd be kind of like struck with all sorts of reactions and stuff. For me, Longchenpa, I wouldn't have any reaction or preconceived notion at all. I had no idea who he even was until he showed up in my dream in response to my plea for help for the world. And even then, I didn't know who he was. I have no idea. It just seemed like someone who would have had something valuable to say. That's all. Man, I still really don't really have much, to do about it. Yeah, he's a colleague, he's a colleague, a very highly esteemed colleague. But other than that, I don't really have much to say or reactions or any baggage. So it might be very easy for me compared. Whereas if someone who's a Tibetan Buddhist, if the Longchenpa was here, they might just, just wow, it would just be too much wow for them. But from a pragmatic standpoint, I don't really have any wow at all associated with that, with the existential, historical, all this kind of tying into a religion or anything like that. I don't experience him being tied into any religion at all. I just see him pointing out the simple truth. That's all. But Jesus, of course, seems to be inexorably tied into Christianity, even though for me, he's not really. I don't really experience them that way either, but it takes a lot of work and to work on that, that's for sure. So Longchenpa would be a very pragmatic help for us, actually, from my standpoint, it'd be very pragmatic. Maybe Jesus will go to hang out with the radical Dzogchen people. They don't have any baggage with him. And he says, "Ah, it's easy to hang out with you." And they say, "Oh yeah, no problem. You're saying pretty much what, what our teachers have said. That's great. You're saying the same thing, actually. So we appreciate that, but we really don't have any baggage, reactions to you historically or anything. Extraneous stuff. There's no extraneous stuff." Yeah, it might happen that way. I don't know. And again, I just say, look, if anyone wants to try to throw all this stuff up and, throw stuff, confetti in the air, I just said, look, longevity is just saying that reality cannot be compounded. Same thing Jesus is saying, reality cannot be compounded. It's impossible. Never happens. And so all our belief in compound matter, these are just illusions. They're meaningless. There's no value there. There's no reason to evaluate illusions. They're all equally untrue. That's, it's a very simple message. There's no forest to get lost in, actually. That's why when I picked up this infant on the side of the road, it was just outside the forest, this huge dark forest that I've been wandering in, and I finally found a way out. Here's this infant that would have been abandoned. I picked it up. I didn't want to just abandon it, so I tried to take care of it, and later on it turns out to be the divine child. I found out it was the divine child itself, which is not in the forest. It's not in the forest of complexity at all. There's no forest of complexity that we're really dealing with here at all. It's just our unnecessary evaluation produces this forest of complexity. The more we see, there's no need to evaluate. We don't have a need to evaluate illusions. We don't have a need to evaluate no need. Okay? We don't have any needs. So we don't have a need to evaluate the fact we don't have any needs. We're not needy. We don't need to evaluate our non-neediness. It is. We don't need to evaluate reality. We don't need to evaluate it. It is the one value. There is no other value. It's ever-present value. What need do we have to evaluate it? And we certainly don't need to evaluate the silly notion that reality has no value at all. There's no value there. Or the attempt to, futile attempts to change reality, they're all futile. So what are we evaluating? We don't need to. Don't need to evaluate. What time is it? Oh, it's getting on there. I have to attend to duties and helping people out. So there's no forest. We're not lost in a forest here at all. We're not lost in a forest. This is pretty much what teachers are how helpful to us is. They're not in any forest of confusion. And that helps us out immeasurably in terms of getting out of that forest and realizing we don't have to cut down one tree at a time. Just let the whole forest go. Let it all just dissolve. Let it all vanish, as it were, without a trace. That's a lot easier than trying to cut down one tree at a time, pull out the stumps and all that. It'd take forever to cut down that big forest, right? So we just let it all just vanish. Or just see the uncompoundness of it all, that there isn't any need to cut any tree down. It's already inherently uncompounded, not compounded. And ideologically, we say it's neither compounded nor is it not compounded. In other words, we're not taking an ideological position on non-compoundment. That's important to keep pointing that out. Because reality doesn't need for us to take a position on reality. And Longchenpa pointed that out, pointed it out. He gets to that very clearly. So the more we hear this, the easier it gets here, that we're not lost in a forest. We don't have to deal with the forest at all. We set it all aside all at once. We're not in the forest. There is no forest of compoundment at all. There's none. Doesn't exist. It's just an illusion. A mirage. It's a mirage. Do we have to set down a mirage piece by piece? A mirage of a forest? Do we need to say, wow, here's a mirage. Let me take this tree and set it aside. Let me set this one aside. That's not a very quick way to do it. It's the old analogy that is used in the East a lot of, instead of trying to get rid of all the stones on the pathways, the pebbles and the thorns and the stones, and walking all around, sort of walking all around the world barefoot, put on a pair of sandals and you'll find you don't have to worry about all those stones and thorns, stickers, whatever. The sandals take care of it. So just realize nothing is compounded, never has been. So we don't need to get rid of the whole mirage. Can just we can just realize it's just a mirage. Now it can the mirage can still be there, but we just see, well, yeah, it's a mirage. Jesus says the vision of the real world is such that everything then appears to be extremely beautiful. This is, I think, Tibetan Buddhism, it is Rigpa or something like that, where everything takes on this unbelievably beautiful saturation and clarity. It's just extraordinarily beautiful. This can happen. We can have that. That's in Tibetan Buddhism. They point that out as a very important a goal to reach. Vision, vision of Christ, vision of the real world. Jesus uses various terms for that. And absolutely, when we see that there is no compoundment at all, everything takes on this indescribable beauty, Jesus calls it, and tinges of light around everything. And so, yeah, I haven't experienced that myself, so I have to look forward to that. But I have faith that it is there. We have cross traditions here, both pointing out the same thing, saying absolutely that we can have a new perception in which everything just seems incredibly beautiful. Not thing, all appearancing, all perception seems to be, you know, just indescribably beautiful and precious. So for those who have worked really hard on the path, and there are those out there, there is no question about it. Many of those viewing these videos are in that boat, have worked really hard, really care about it, and we want to succeed. We want to succeed. So we want to go for it. We want to go for success. It's a bottom line time. Everyone has to get to the bottom line right now and find the best advice they can and then follow it and follow it adamantly right now. Is because we what's coming in the world, we have to get to the bottom line of what our beliefs are and realize the fruit of our beliefs now. That's the bottom line. Have to do that. We can't fool around anymore with this world, imagining that imperilment's not going to happen in some way. This is the very purpose of this world, is imperilment. So of course it's going to happen. It's always happening, actually. I went back and looked at the 80s, and I realized just how terrible the 80s were. It was awful. It was awful, really. If we were imperiled in so many ways then, ideologically, and just, it was just terrible. And I realized every generation has been terrible. The 60s were not really good, nice at all either, near the 70s. It's all been awful, actually. So why should the future be any different? It won't, but actually it could be a lot worse. At the very least, it'll be just as bad, and in the way it's looking, it's going to be a lot worse. So we want to get to the bottom line of our beliefs and experience the fruition of our beliefs and our efforts. So an intensive push and focus on it is certainly going to be beneficial. It's certainly going to be absolutely beneficial. I don't know how much in every individual unique situation, but it certainly will be very beneficial. So I'm trying to get myself going here better than I've been doing. I mean, looking back, I say, wow, I've really been pushing things to an extreme extent. But I got to get back and maybe push it even more somehow. I don't know if that's possible. I'll try. It's a little different. Before, I read the entire book through of Longchenpa. But now I'm saying, let's focus on one chapter and let that dig in deeply. Before, I wanted just to make sure that I really could get through it all, and I can. But now, I'm taking just one sentence and I'm looking at it and just say, wow, that one sentence just resonates profoundly. And that's all I need, just to experience the absolute sameness of everything. Yeah, that's what I want. Let's do that right now. Right now, the absolute sameness. Let's do that right now. You don't really have to go through the whole book. It's all pointing out the same truth. Same thing with A Course in Miracles. I might just go back and just read one sentence. That's it. That's all I need, just that sentence. I don't have to go through the whole book. I keep thinking about getting one of those heaters. Nice heaters. Oh, my gosh. Some restaurants have them outside. You got in the cold winter, and they turn on these wonderful overhead heaters. It's just like, ah, it just feels so nice, toasty. A lot of houses are getting these now, and their porches, actually, the more expensive homes. These radiant heaters, they're getting more and more sophisticated, less energy consumptive, and you don't have to freeze like I'm freezing out here. Yeah. That's the one trouble with winter for me. So we'll see. We'll see what happens. We'll see what our friends do. Our friends who are just pointing out the simple truth to us, so we need not be afraid of them at all. They're just saying reality cannot be compounded, never has been compounded. And that's perfectly okay. We don't have a need to compound it. We don't have such a need. It's a whim, not a need. We've been following a whim, not a need. But we were intrigued by wondering if we could do it. So we told ourselves it was a need. So we would continue to pursue it. So that could be follow this adventure that we're on. But if we realized it's just a whim, it would have lost steam right away. We'd say, ah, I'm not going to. That's a silly adventure, ridiculous. So we just told ourselves it was a need, and then claimed that God told us that was. Thinking, well, we are God, the Spirit, so we should have the authority to say that it is a need, but we don't have that authority. We didn't create ourselves. God, the Prime Creator, created us. So we cannot change what we are. So we cannot say it's just a need and make it true. It's not. It's a whim. It's just a whim. Just a whim. Just a whim. Just a whim. And a whim is really nothing. It's just a desire for adventure. That's all it is. We just had this desire for adventure. There's no need to. God didn't say, well, you need to have this adventure. No, we're completely free. We don't need to have any particular adventure at all. Whatever it is, we do. You might say we do need to adventure in general. This is how God created us. But we don't need any adventure in specific. And non-adventuring is also a venture, actually, in some ways. You could say that. So we just had this whim of maybe this would be an interesting adventure. Well, it has been interesting. And I think our interest is waning, though. We're losing interest in it, which is fine also. There's no need to say, well, we must keep staying on this venture forever. There's no, we can if we want. If we lose interest, that's fine. Then we can take up some other adventure. And that's what we want to do because we're losing interest in this one. Most definitely. The world is desperately trying to keep interested. Shop, 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 shop. Stay away from shopping. It's a severe addiction. I don't even go into stores. I try not to go into any malls, stores. No way. No way. It's a very bad addiction. I have suffered from my shopping and from other shopping, bringing great troubles upon me. It's a nasty, terrible addiction. And this is what most of the world say, wow, yeah, we just got to shop. It's the number one activity in the world right now is shopping. Didn't used to be that way. You grew up in the country, in the farm, Maybe you never even go to a big city. Maybe you go to five and dime store and buy a shirt every now and then or pants or something. That's it. Nowadays, it just, I mean, walking through Saks, Saks Fifth Avenue, it's like, whoa, this is ridiculous. I mean, just the ornamentation and decoration and the way they presented everything. And I mean, it's just like, and the sophistication of all the fashions of everything is just off the charts right now. So I would highly suggest everybody stay out of those stores. Just stay out of them. I did end up buying a hat somewhere. It's a very sophisticated hat. I don't even know if I can wear it. I don't even know if I what I would wear it with. It's an awesome hat, but I just haven't really worn it around yet. No. I told the guy, "What am I going to wear this with?" He goes, "Oh, it goes with anything." I say, "Are you kidding me?" I said, "You have to be very, very confident in yourself to wear a hat like this. You can't just, you know." He said, "Oh, no, sure, it goes with everything." Well, maybe he thought that I could wear it. He thought, "Oh, yeah, you can wear this hat," but it's a very dapper hat to say the least. And I don't know if I can wear it at all. Actually, I don't know. Maybe I will some point. That's it. I said, I just buy the hat. That's it. No more buying. Stay away from stores. I made the mistake of wandering into one store. And I said, uh-oh, I could feel trouble here, no question. I said, all right, when in Rome, do as Romans do. Let me just get a hat and we get out of here. Get out of here relatively unscathed, actually. I looked in some other stuff. I said, let me just get out of here. The guy was trying to, they had so many salespeople in there, it was ridiculous. Must have had like 10 salespeople in the small store. Everybody came in. Hey, how you doing? My name's so and so. Nice to meet you. Oh wow, yeah, look at this. You look great in that. Yeah, I mean, that's really trying to sell. They're everywhere, these salespeople. They outnumbered the customers 2 to 1. It was amazing. But it worked, you know, it worked. Stay out. Stay away from shop. Well, it's the shopping season, isn't it? This is insanity. It's now a national insanity. It is starting a Black Friday. Actually, people start shopping way before that, even on Thanksgiving. But they start lining up on Thanksgiving. I think they open the doors at 6 o'clock in the afternoon on Thanksgiving. But there's this insanity of shopping. This is the Christmas. I'm boycotting Christmas actually this year. I gotta boycott it. It's ridiculous. It's an obscenity right now. Total obscenity. Christmas is being hijacked by the materialists right now. We're supposed to focus on the symbology of Christ and Christianity during this time because it's extremely important to do so. And we've lost the symbology of it and the depth and profundity of it, and now we're made this obscene juxtaposition of shopping, 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 shopping. Boycott it. I already got all my presents. I just got some candied fruits for everybody, and that's it. I was just in a supermarket, and I just said, oh, this'll work. Got it with my groceries, and I'm finished. Boycott Christmas now. Boycott it. It's an obscenity. They've gotten rid, gotten, they've took and taken the Christ out of Christmas. They absolutely have. It's just Xmas now. Xmas. Xmas. Really. Happy holidays. Happy shopping holidays. Terrible, 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 terrible trend in the world. Disastrous for especially for Christian countries who this is, you know, supremely important to remind ourselves there's something that we need to pay attention to, something we need to attend to. Christianity says there's something very important you need to attend to. This is what Jesus was saying, very important. You must believe, have faith that this is true, what I'm telling you. There's something very important you must attend to. Well, there is. Of course, we must evaporate our continuity fear so we can abide in the non-dual, uncompounded nature of reality. Absolutely. This is what we have to attend to. And so the Christmas is a time that's just been developed throughout centuries, and to focus in on this. I mean, get rid of the materialism. And we're not, that's the opposite. You know, there's all this materialism is exactly, then shopping is exactly the opposite of what we're supposed to be doing. This is a time of fasting and of prayer and contemplation and all of that. That's what it's supposed to be, actually. So I think the best Christian thing anyone can do is to boycott Xmas right now. That would be well, I'm giving that advice right now as a Christian. As a friend of Jesus, a conscious friend of Jesus, I say now, boycott Christmas. Boycott it. Now, if you do that, your family will get furious with you. Everyone will get furious, right? How difficult is that? Well, I actually been boycotting Christmas for quite some time. I haven't used those words, but now I am using those words. This has gone over the edge now. It's sick. It's absolutely sick. The obsession that people have, that, you know, this is like now this month is the most important month of the year. We got to buy, 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 buy. Well, I'm helped out a lot because I don't have any money. Can't buy anything, really. So it makes it easy. Get some candy and here it is. That's it. So So yeah, I always say that being a pauper is a great blessing. A great blessing. And I advise those who don't make it this lifetime, next lifetime, aim for a birth in a situation where you'll be poor, a pauper, quite poor, and not have money to shop and not have money to divert yourself in all sorts of ways. This is a great, great blessing. Great, great blessing. Because it's a great excuse. You can say, hey, I just can't get involved in this. I don't have any money to get involved in it. Not having money has kept me out of thousands and thousands of bad situations that I would have gotten involved in. No question about it. I mean, I would have been a jet setter if I had the money. Really? Absolutely. I've probably been hanging out with Jagger and his friends or something, right? I mean, just one of the beautiful people, jet setters. If I had millions and millions of dollars when I was young, I would have gotten into that. So again, not having money, I would say, is it may be the biggest blessing of my life. What I do, I can sit here and read Longchenpa, I can read A Course in Miracles, I can do that, and that's about it. So let me do some more of it, and let me do some more of it, and let me do some more of it, and let me do some more of it. I can't go out, can't go out. 'Cause I don't have any money to go out. So let me. What can I do? Well, I can read. Let me do some more of it. Let me do some more. I can sit here, contemplate. Let me do some more of it. That's how it's gone. That's how it's gone. So, I again advise everyone in the next life, those who don't make this life their last one, to look for a very modest, very moral, very modest circumstances in your life where you will not be distracted by the lure of what money can provide you in this world, where you will not be distracted by it. If you needed to work through some stuff like the shopping addictions and stuff, then somehow it will come to you, but you end up paying a price for that, which I certainly did. But you will find out there will be ways to work through whatever you need to work through. But again, the bottom line is look for a situation where you don't have hardly any money and you rely on others to help you out. So you really can't do very much at all except study, 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 practice, 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 practice. That is profoundly helpful, profoundly helpful. And this is what Christianity tells us is to be meek, and the poor and the meek, and we inherit the kingdom. And it's talking about how it's harder for a richer person to go get in the kingdom of heaven than it is for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. This is what Jesus emphasized, this that riches are a great hindrance, and they are. They're a great, great hindrance, actually. You squander your life. You squander your life purchasing what money can buy you, really, vacations here, diversions here. You squander your life that way. And I simply was unable to do it. I was unable to do it. I'm not saying I'm some great person. I certainly would have done it if I had the money. Absolutely, I would have done it. I would have been taking golf vacations all the time, doing this and that. And I would have squandered my life for sure. So the great blessing, the grace of my life was that I had no money to do it. And the funny thing, other people put me into monetary trouble, so I couldn't even put it on a credit card. It didn't matter what I did, I ended up in a bad monetary situation, so I couldn't do hardly anything. No matter what happened, no matter what I tried, it just wouldn't get away from me. Wouldn't leave me, wouldn't leave me, and it hasn't left me yet. I'm now in a worse situation than ever, monetarily. So it just doesn't leave me, not yet. Hopefully it will lighten up a little bit here soon. It would be good. I don't think I would go around squandering at this point. Maybe I would, maybe I wouldn't. I kind of doubt it. Might be able to use it wisely. I don't know. It's up to the Holy Spirit. He knows better than I do. But yeah, it's getting a little. This world's getting pretty scary in terms of You need a credit score. I mean, if you pay stuff everything with cash, you've got no credit history, and you can't rent. I mean, I'm now become aware of this. People saying, "Hey, they have a credit score, but they have some issue with a credit report, not having a history." And someone was telling me today that their friend has been working for cash for a while now, and they're trying to rent an apartment. And there's no history of their, credit history as far as putting charging stuff. So basically, you're supposed to charge stuff, and you can't even rent now if you don't have a credit card and charge on the credit card and get this show that you're responsible in paying off your credit card. That's what they're looking for. And if you don't have that, they won't rent to you. It's amazing. So I don't know if this guy was in a problem because he's been being paid in cash and using cash to buy stuff. So literally, we're being forced into a cashless society. Otherwise, you can't have any lodging, basically. It's insane. I don't know if using debit cards is a similar thing or not. I don't know. I don't have a credit card anymore. It's debit. That's it. So I'm wondering, how do I get? Maybe, you can't rent, you can't buy, you can't rent, you can't do this. You have no credit. You're not using a credit card. Absolutely nuts. Scary. The whole way finances are going, it's very scary because I have zero interest in going in that direction. I have no interest in all the way that they're dealing with finances now and complexities and the changes they're making. I'm not interested in going there. I don't feel I can function at all in such a society. I prefer cash, actually. I prefer cash. Always have. Always have. Just prefer cash. How much is it? $20. Here's a $20 bill. That's it. Done. Done. No record transaction. I don't have to I pay the tax there, the tax, whatever the tax is, and that's it. I much prefer a cash-based society. But they're going to eliminate that, actually. Eliminate it. Force you into credit cards. I don't want credit cards anymore. I've had enough hideous trouble. Forget credit cards. Do away with them. It'll greatly lessen our materialism if we do away with credit cards. It's a horrible road we're going down there. You got cash? You're looking at how much cash I have. Can I afford it? No. Goodbye. This is how much I have in my wallet. This is how much I can spend. And oh, I can't do that. Okay, let me sit at home and read Longchenpa or Jesus, and study like I'm supposed to study and evaporate the con. I feel like I'm supposed to evaporate it. Let me do that instead. That's what's proper, right and just and proper for us. Because this reveals the truth of our being to us, whereas this materiality obscures it and diverts us from what we need to do so it stands revealed to us, diverts us away from it. So it's a dead end. It's a very dark dead end we're going down here in this world. Radically, radically dark dead end that we're going down now. I like going to the zoo and take a camel ride. $5. Here's $5 bills. I get to go on a camel. Great. No credit card needed. It's a good old fashioned cash. It'd be really cool to go on like a 100-mile camel ride or something. Yeah, that would be awesome. But there again, see, if I had the money, I would do it. Diversion, diversion, right? Diversion. There's so many, 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 many things now in the world available to us. Infinitely more than before, if we have the money for it. If we have the money, you can write your ticket. There's the tours and the diversions are off the chart in terms of sophistication and the amount of them. Whereas before, there wasn't so much to do, really. And if you had the money, it was not that much to do. You go out to dinner, get a nice steak dinner. You know, somebody get a, you know, filet mignon. It's, oh, I went out to dinner tonight. It's a lot of sophisticated. But now there's like every trek possible, every jungle experience, island experience, you know, you name it. Somebody is offering a service for you to do something and ride a dune buggy, you know, all over the Sahara or whatever. I mean, just, it goes on and on and on and on and on, all the sophistication. Whatever you want to do, if you have the money, you can do it. Terrible situation, actually, for us. Because this is all diversionary. It's all diversionary. It's all diversionary. And, you know, only the grace of God helps us out. Sometimes we get an accident, sometimes something happens and we have to stop doing this stuff. And then we realize, hey, and then we maybe we get sick and we have to, then we say, what do I do? Oh, I see this book, let me read this book and say, hey, this is pretty interesting. Somehow grace gets us back on track. But we're not making it easy on ourselves, that is for sure. But even people in places where they're rehab centers and stuff, they're not paying attention to the spiritual job they need to do. They have a great opportunity. Maybe they're, you know, temporarily disabled or something, and what do? They sit around watching TV all day. This is ridiculous. They used to have a Gidgen Bible at least in everywhere, and people go in a hotel room, they'd open the door and there's a Gidgen Bible, and they say, let me do some Bible study here. It's a good idea. Good idea. Great idea. Nowadays, there's no more Gidgen Bible. I think a lot of places have eliminated that. Now you've got this idiot box that you can watch thousands of different psychopathic programs on, channels on, and which are just diversionary, extraordinarily diversionary. Television's extraordinarily diversionary, as are movies. The whole entertainment industry is extraordinarily diversionary. By the way, musicians are not nearly as talented as they seem to be. It's the producers. There's some very genius producers who can put the chrome on it all. They do. It's like a Harley with all chrome. You know, they really spice it up like a great chef, and they produce. And here's this band, and they're like, wow, this sounds incredible. Well, it's the genius producers who are doing it, actually. So don't get too carried away with these musicians. Perfect example is Blondie, the group Blondie, Parallel Lines, one of the best albums in history, right up there, right at the top. Well, that's the producer, Mark Chapman, is the one who produced this. It's work of art, work of genius, the production. It turned a decent band into something that is just like, just wow. The singer, you know, I mean, they're not that great. The singer, he's not that good of a singer, and it's just okay. I mean, the musicians are okay; they're all right, and they got attitude, a lot of, you know, vamping and attitude and stuff. But the songs are incredible, and you know, a lot of the credit goes to the producer, absolutely. So don't get carried away by these musicians. These days, most everything's done by computer, digitally. You know, they don't have any talent at all. They can just be a bunch of vacuous vamps, coked out vacuous vamps, which is, you know, somewhat what Deborah Harry was, actually, in Blondie. She's the role model for all of that, actually. She's severely coked out and just vamped all over the place like some zombie. A lot, you know, had some, you know, just conveying attitude, a ton of attitude, and had some ability to do that, no question. But that's sort of a role model of nowadays. They don't have to have talent. It's all the tone adjustments, auto tune and auto tone, auto this, auto that, auto that. It's the producers that put the wow into the music. Parallel Lines is just insane. The songs on there, they're so good. It's just like, how in the world did they do this? You know, they did well. They had somebody who had the knack, as it were. And it's funny that later, then he went from Blondie to the knack, producing the knack, which was never as good. Never reached the high water mark. But there are these great producers, George Martin with the Beatles, Billy Sherrill with George Jones and the Contrapolitan Sound of Nashville. And yeah, it goes on and on. There are Quincy Jones is a really good producer, and Motown had some good producers, and you have these genius producers who just have the knack to, I mean, you do multi-layers of vocals, and layer the vocals and put the right kind of delay on it, just all sorts of stuff that just fill it out in the right way. It's an art. It's an art. It's a rare art. I mean, I'm not that good at it. I realize that I could not. I'm not good enough to be a producer in music. I had all the technical stuff. I mean, as far as the equipment, but no, that is very difficult. It's a genius. It's to it. I don't understand how they do it. Phil Spector was another one that was quite successful. Brian Wilson, the Beach Boys, it's interesting that the three B's, Beatles, Beach Boys, and Blondie, stand the test of time. You look back, you realize the music still stands up just spectacularly. Well, they had great production. All three of those had great production work behind them. And in the case of the Beach Boys, they had studio musicians, the Wrecking Crew behind them. So that was a pretty strong combination there, that's for sure. So really, the producers are way more musical geniuses than the artists themselves. Way more. They're like, they understand the whole picture of the ultimate sound and just pull in all this stuff and know how it, what it should sound like. And it's like Brian Wilson was a genius producer of the Beach Boys. He really was. And he told the Wrecking Crew exactly what he wanted to hear. And they came with all these novel sounds and everything. But he knew how to put it all together. He was just, amazing genius at it. So, yeah, musicians, just musicians. Don't get carried away. Some vamped out cokehead, it's just a vamped out cokehead. And they can posture and pose and pout and look and cop all these attitudes and stuff. It's just juvenile stuff of is all it is, and it's really not that cool at all. Even though the songs that the producers can produce may sound really cool. Yeah, pretty good ear candy. But just see it as it is and say, okay, that's it is what it is. These musicians aren't that cool at all. I've never met a really cool musician. There aren't any really. There aren't really any cool musicians. Really cool musicians. Not really. I don't know. Maybe there's a couple around, a few here and there, but very far and few between. Very few and far between. It's a lot to do with attitude and the sound and the technology and the equipment and a lot of different stuff. What's cool is spiritual practice. That's what's really cool. Nothing beats that for cool. That's the highest cool there is. Nothing even comes close to it. So if you're really doing spiritual practice, you know you're cool in regards to the world, as far as relatively speaking, but also absolutely speaking, it is the cool thing to do. There's no, so I'm unabashed in saying that it is absolutely the cool thing to do. I feel I am cool in that regard because I've done something that's really cool, is spiritual practice, and continue to. And you should feel the same way. Yeah, you've got to have a positive perspective on what you're doing. You can't say, "Oh, this is the musicians, they're so cool, and this is nothing." No, they're not cool. They're not even close to this. Not even remotely close. Not even touch upon it. Don't even touch upon it. And we need to bring back the cool of spiritual practice, spiritualization. That's what's really cool. That's what we need to bring back to the world to help out. It has to be. We have to have role models that people look up to and say, wow, this is really cool. I want to do that too. This is what musicians did, right? They seemed so cool. The Beatles seemed so uber cool. Everybody wanted to be, you know, like the Beatles or the Rolling Stones. They were the flip side of the Beatles. They were the more the street cool. The grunge, the street, hard edge, the raggedy cool. And so, you know, we want to be kind of, grew up, oh, I want to kind of be a musician. I want to be that cool. I want to be that cool. I want to be that cool. And swept everybody up into the coolness of pop music and pop culture and all that stuff. And we lost sight of how cool it is to work our spiritual path. That's what's really the ultimate in coolness. Nothing comes even remotely close to this. So I try to keep my sense of coolness and calm collectedness and saying, hey, I'm doing something really, really, really interesting here and valuable in this world. Wherever I go, because I'm just unknown, wherever I go, nobody pays the slightest bit of attention to me at all. And so you have to try to keep yourself feeling that, you know, what I'm doing is valuable, it's important, it's really cool, because nobody else would even recognize. In fact, today I said to somebody, we're talking about getting older, Kobe Bryant's retiring, he's been in the league 20 years, I said, oh my gosh, he started in 1996, 20 years already for Kobe, that's insane. I remember when he was just drafted out of high school, and I said, oh, has that 20 years gone by, is that possible? It means I'm getting older, and then I realized I am getting older. And I told this man I was talking with about, and I said, man, I realized I gotta work on my legacy here. I mean, this is just crazy. I mean, yeah, I want to leave a legacy. And he burst out in laughter. He thought it was hilarious to say that. Yeah, it's his legacy. Yeah, legacy. I said, he said, forget legacy. Forget about legacy. I just, you know, I'm just trying to survive or something. So he thought it was quite funny. I had a good laugh too at his laughter. But I'm used to leaving legacy in this world. This is something I've done before, maybe more than once, actually. So for me, leaving legacy is important. Is important for others that are, you know, continuing on with this delusion of trying to evaluate illusions. They need legacies. I mean, I look for legacies. Longchenpa, you know, legacy, Jesus, legacy. Where's the legacy? Ramana Maharshi, legacy. We want legacies. I want legacies that I can look at and say, this is something very valuable. I can see the value of this, and this is something I can go towards. So it's, legacy is super important in this world. Super important. We should try to leave a legacy. So false humility is not a good thing at all. If you're doing something really cool and want to leave a legacy, by all means do so. By all means do so. It helps others immensely. Imagine if there was no Ramana Maharshi, how more impoverished this world would be. Terrible. I can't imagine it. He's been a light to our modern age. So many, many, many people have been inspired directly or indirectly through those who have been inspired, and they went on and be teachers, and you know, it's just mushroomed into a huge cottage industry of non-dual teaching. He's been spectacularly helpful, spectacular legacy that continues to grow. So thank God for these legacies. And so I just mentioned, wow, I don't have much time left to leave a legacy. I better get going on this. Encourage one another in greatness. Encourage one another in greatness and legacy building so that we help others. This is very important. And having done it before, it feels natural and normal to me. I don't shy away from it. I just say, yeah, I've done it before. And I know what it's like. I know what it's like. I know what it's like to come back in the world and look at the legacy that you left in a previous life. I know what that's like. I experienced it. I didn't pay much attention to it, really. I said, well, I hope it helped out, but I want to do better, because it really didn't help out enough. Didn't help out enough. It didn't do what I wanted it to do, actually. Didn't stop World War II, which ultimately I wanted to help stop conflict, especially Germany. I tried to lead Germany away from conflict, you know, the route they were going, the humanistic route they were going. I said, it's going to be a disaster. And it turned out to be a disaster, but I wasn't able to leave a legacy that prevented that. So I was very mortified by this. You know, it didn't work. It was insufficient. And I still, I'm not happy about that. But it seems as though whatever legacy we leave here in the world, pretty many people don't pay any attention to it at all. They continue to get caught up in the trap of imperilment, which is inevitable. If you understand how the dynamics of delusion work, you know, it's inevitable that conflict arises. Severe conflict, projection, and all these dynamics, wars will happen. Lack of peace will happen. Impairment will happen. So music wasn't enough. Music wasn't enough. It doesn't inspire people enough to avoid terrible impairment. It does not. In fact, in a lot of cases, it just exacerbates it. And, of course, some religion, the ego twisting it and distorting it and using it as diversion, diverting us from it, that also leads, that doesn't save us from conflict either. It doesn't cause it. People think religion causes wars. It doesn't. It just oftentimes doesn't stop wars. Because the religion is just become a sophisticated excuse to avoid what we really need to do, which is practice non-dual abidance. So again, religion doesn't actually cause wars. The warlikeness, it comes from our delusion, our own arrogance and delusion and continuity fear and fear and projection and all this inner conflict. Projecting that out, and the fear is so strong, it gives rise to attack and feeling you're being attacked and attacked. It comes from us, our attempt to change what we are. That's where it comes from. It doesn't come from religion. But many religious people engage in warfare, etc., because they're not really not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Just as the secular people are not doing what they're supposed to be doing. This, the 20th century is a century of warfare from secular sources. Terrible. So, secularity doesn't help. Religion often doesn't help. But between the two of them, certainly you want religion, you want to make it as good as possible, because there is something we must do that is related to God and to our being and truth of our being and the fact that we have tried to change what we are, and that we're really spiritual beings. We are not human beings at all. God didn't create human beings. God created in his own likeness, a spirit and truth, formless spirit and truth. And so we do have to, a God-centered religions, or a non-dual-centered religion, so to speak, is necessary. It's helpful. Secular atheism, humanistic atheism, materialism, that's not helpful. It's not helpful. It's led to very, very nasty stuff. And they wrongly accuse religion of, it's religion that caused it. No. Again, it's just that religion hasn't been that successful in preventing, although it has probably prevented a lot worse. It could have been a lot worse here if not for religion. Just keep in mind how terrible it used to be in ancient times. Just ridiculously terrible. The Assyrians, there's so many groups just that their whole life was get up in the morning and let's go out and slaughter people. Take over their lands. That's it. That's what they thought was life. It's true. Every spring the Assyrians would get up and say, okay, they spent all winter preparing their war machine, and then they just say, okay, what direction haven't we gone out in? Let's go out in this direction. And they just go out and they come across a village and they just kill everybody and take everything and then go to the next village, same thing, or enslave them or something. And this is what their life was. And this was not uncommon at all. Not uncommon at all. This was the ancient times. It's horrible. So we have cut down somewhat on our attack. So religions have helped out quite a bit. It's just that we can do so much better. So much better. And we cannot throw out faith and replace it with works. That's a nasty little sleight of hand that's taking place right now. Very bad. Okay, well, I do have to attend. I'm a little late attending. I got carried away, which is great. This is what it's all about. Don't shortcut your practicing just because You do have to help somebody out. They can wait a few minutes, right? That's a very small price to pay for the value that they're ultimately getting from setting legacies, from setting examples, from ultimately being available to help. All this stuff. It's very, very important. Okay. Blessings to everyone, and keep going for it here. Don't let anybody stop you. Very great. That's it.